Hey, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Off the Cuff. I'm Justin Drager.
I'm Karen McCarthy from NASFA's policy team.
And I'm Jon Fansmith with ACE's government relations team.
Glad to have you back, Jon. Welcome. This might be the last time we're all together before the new year, unless there is some major breaking legislation or news, which we'll get to in this podcast if there's going to be any additional legislation specifically on spending bills. I also want to talk today about loan forgiveness and some of the timing around when there might be judgments there. And the big news, at least in our profession this last week, was the GAO report, the government accountability report about aid offers. Before we get to all of that, though, let me bring in our producer this week, Maria. Maria, any questions or comments from the off-the-cuff community from this last week? Anything there?
Yeah, so based on last week's episode on FSA, some members are wondering if FAFSA simplification will be ready to go on October 1st.
Yeah, I get why they would have that question, because we raised this point last week in that we never heard them say it will be ready on October 1st. Now, they had talked about it being on track, and they had talked about, you know, some of really high level like plans and maps to have schematics out in the, you know, winter, spring and summer. But they didn't use the word October 1st. And you kind of never know whether that's on purpose or whether that was an oversight. And what I would say is the department has not said the FAFSA won't be available on October 1st. I think our question is more of, was that on purpose or will it not be available on October 1st? And so NASFA is trying to get an answer to that. We're not trying to sow any conspiracy theories, except that if it's not going to be available on October 1st, the law requires it to be available by January 1st, and we would like to know when the actual date is. And obviously, schools would want to know that now so they can plan for it now. So the department hasn't said that it won't be, but I think of maybe the thing that's piqued our ears a little bit is they didn't say it will be.
And they did say, though, 24-25. They do. I mean, they do say it's on track for release for the 24-25 FAFSA.
So, but you would take that, Karen, to mean it's going to be ready for the 24-25 year, not the date at which it will be ready.
Yes. Yes. I just don't want anybody to think, well, if it's not October 1, is it like 2 years from now? Or are we going to have, are they going to release a kind of an old FAFSA on October 1? Or no, they have said they're on track for 24-25. They just haven't specified like month and day.
Right. By law, though, it would be January 1. That's what's right in the law.
Right.
Okay.
Right. October 1 is not in the law. We've kind of gotten used to it, but
that,
and we've
voluntary
asked for it. Yes. Yes.
By department, when we went to prior year, they backed it up to October 1. So, okay.
Yes.
All right. Thanks very much, Maria. All right. Let's jump in here. This last week, the GAO released a report looking at aid offers. And John and Karen, just initial impressions from the report. What are your impressions, John?
Yeah. I mean, sadly, not a surprise, right? I think in a lot of ways, the report validated the concerns we've had here in Washington, D.C. in the associations, and speaks to the work that, you know, we've been doing, and frankly, the need for a whole lot more. You know, from a presidential association perspective, I think we are getting to this point where hopefully it's landing on presidents' radar screens, because we have, it's been a policy discussion of, you know, pretty reasonable intensity over the last decade. And it still kind of plays out where there's a lot of internal campus politics about how our resources allocated, where do you pursue policy, what drives that, who are the decision makers there. And I think at this point, it's become increasingly clear presidents need to be more active, be more aware of what their institutional policies are in this regard, and take a stronger role in framing how they want their institution to move forward. I think we think very clearly there's got to be greater transparency, there's got to be greater comparability, there's got to be ease of understanding for students. That's not always what we're seeing, which is what the GAO pointed out. Presidents need to step up a little bit here and make sure that their institutions are committed to that.
Yeah, and I appreciate that, John. And we'll get into some of that, because part of the report got into like the reasons why aid offers aren't always clear, at least from the financial aid perspective.
Yeah.
And some of that can really only be sorted by, you know, the executives on a college campus, the president or his or her designee. Karen, overall impressions?
Yeah, I would say, you know, we at NASFA have been tackling this issue for almost a decade now, and kind of with the approach of encouraging schools to do somewhat of self-regulation, like let's everybody get on the same page with regards to best practices. And NASFA has put out a whole bunch of resources to help schools with model aid offers and how to evaluate aid offers, make sure that you are including these components on your aid offers. We've included a lot of the best practices in our code of conduct since, I think, 2014, they have been there. And I do think that this GAO report, when this was released, somewhat shows the limitations of that self-regulation effort, and agree with John on it does bring to light some needs that are out there, and that perhaps we do need something more forceful than just straight, you know, self-regulate unless we want rules coming down from high above, which has been our approach over the last decade.
So I'm hearing an acknowledgement of this issue and of the concern, and for good reason. The GAO, just at a high level, said that they had identified basically 10 best practices. We'll talk about those in just a moment, but nearly two-thirds of colleges follow half or fewer of those 10 best practices. 41% of colleges do not include a net price on their aid offers, which leaves students, of course, trying to figure out how much they're going to pay out of pocket, whether through financing or cash or work study. And that an estimated 50% of colleges understate the net price. Put another way, like schools are miscalculating what is a net price. And we've talked about that for a long time. Folks, calculating the net price is basic. I mean, that's basic.
Yeah.
So some troubling findings here, but let's dig into this piecemeal. Let's start with the methodology, because I have heard several folks raise concerns about the methodology. How could 176 schools represent a national representative sample? Let me talk just for a moment about that, and then see if you have anything you want to add here, Karen. The way that this study was conducted was the GAO looked at the whole universe of post-secondary institutions offering Title IV funds. Then they pulled out a sample from those schools, a statistical sample. And I guess I should add that, you know, going back to statistics 101, random sampling is how you analyze a really large population using a smaller, more manageable version. So this is done mathematically. This study used a generalized stratified random sample, so statistically valid. And they use that to then extrapolate out over the entire population. And they do so with a confidence level. And this one was done with a plus or minus 7%. What they didn't, I don't think, have was a random sample for each sector type, because they said that the statistical model did not hold true for sector type, but it did hold true for the universe of institutions. And we use random sampling all the time. I mean, NIPSAS is done with random sampling. So we do accept these statistical models as a valid sample. So does 176 represent? No, it's not every school, but for statistical model purposes, this is a valid study. The other question we get from schools is, am I on the list? Well, GAO identified schools, then went to those schools and said, we would like you to submit to us 3 aid offers that actually went to students that meet certain criteria. And in this instance, they wanted things like Pell Grant recipients, people who had received certain types of loans or other aid. And so are you on the list? Well, if you would have been on the list, if you had been contacted by GAO, is the list public? No. In fact, GAO went out of its way to mask institutional aid offers that were in its report. I don't know the answer to this, Karen or John, but, you know, could that be FOIA'd or something? I have no idea. It's GAO.
I don't. You would assume it would be FOIA-able because it's public information, but I am sure there are exemptions to FOIA for protecting the anonymity of data sources or other things, which would otherwise preclude people from ever participating if they were submitting it confidentially and it could simply just be revealed. I don't know. Again, this is where, okay, I emphasize I'm not a lawyer.
Well, here's what I would say. It's almost moot, okay? And let me try to say this why to schools, okay? Like, I understand schools are concerned, like, am I going to be identified as a school that's not following standards? The answer to that question is that the GAO just released a report that was referenced in every single major news outlet. So what that means is over the next 12 months, particularly, I mean, now and then probably in the fall when aid offers start up again, every local news station is going to find aid offers from schools and going to publish those. So it's a moot point whether your institution is individually on the list. Like the time for making sure your aid offer is up to snuff is like past. It's now.
I would also point out, if you're concerned about your aid offers being in the public, that's a pretty telling indicator. You should probably revise how you do your aid offers.
Right. And no school president or aid director wants to be held out as an example of what not to do. The way that so schools submitted, 176 schools actually submitted aid offers to the GAO for review. They also filled out a questionnaire. And I do have some questions about the questionnaire, but the questionnaire asked things like some of their practices and whether they used like the college financing plan, for example. So that was the methodology. Karen, anything you want to add there?
No, I don't think so. I think you mentioned the kind of the key thing, and that this study of award letters was a little bit different than some in the past that some other organizations have reviewed award letters, but those other organizations obtained their award letters primarily from students directly rather than from institutions. So that methodology was a little bit different in this go around and the randomized sampling, because GAO just has that ability that private organizations wouldn't have had.
So NASFA did participate in the GAO study. We reached out to institutions and encouraged them to participate. We've been in regular contact with them since they've been working on this, which goes back several years now. And we gave them resources that we've been building and providing around consumer testing and some of our own standards in our profession. So, we knew this study was happening. We encouraged schools to participate. This is important for self-reflection and improvement. So we've been supportive along the way. Let's turn to findings for just a moment. And I want to talk specifically about the 10 standards that they basically used as their rubric as to whether a financial aid offer was up to par. The 10 standards were basically taken from two sources. One was from the Financial Literacy Education Council, which was a couple of years ago chaired by the Secretary of the Treasury, included 22 federal agencies, and they came up with a set of 6 standards. And then, separate from that, the Department of Education came up with 8 best practices that they sort of put out there for the community to look at. NASFA highlighted both of these when they were released by their respective agency or task force. But from those two, then GAO compiled 10. Those 10 things included an itemized key of direct and indirect costs on every aid offer, provide a total cost of attendance that includes those key costs, estimate the net price, which, just so we're all on the same page, is cost minus gift aid. Separate out gift aid from loans from work study. They should not be lumped in together. They say number 5 is do not include Parent PLUS loans, or if they're included, separate and differentiate them from all other student loans. They should be separate and apart. Label the type of aid. So call loans, loans, work study, grants, grants. Label the source of the aid. Number 8, include actionable next steps. Number 9, highlight key details about the distinctions between loans and grants, and then do not refer to the offer as an award, which, for our vernacular, it's aid offer. A couple comments here, and then John, Karen would love to hear your thoughts on those 10 things. If they say that no schools met all 10 of these, but if they were to say 9 out of 10 of them met the first 6, then I would put a almost a big green check mark on that and say, you know, these folks are in B plus, A minus territory. So if they called their aid offer an award and not an offer, but they got everything else right, then I'm sort of like, okay, you know, not a big deal. If half of the schools are miscalculating net price, that is a big deal. So not all of these things are equal, and we don't have the exact breakdowns from the GAO about how many are meeting these criteria versus those. What we do know, though, is that a significant number of schools were miscalculating net price, weren't including the costs on their aid offers, and that is in fact a challenge. The other thing I was just a little, I had some questions about is that they said a third of the institutions were using the college financing plan. the college financing plan meets all 10 of these standards. So I'm also confused. I mean, just a question, which is if 10 of the schools are using the college financing plan, how can they also then not be in compliance with all of these 10 things? Now, I understand that all of this, that there were very few schools, like I think they said like two or three that were only using the financing plan. The majority of the third that were using the financing plan were supplementing with their own aid offers. But still, they were offering the financing plan. So I just have a question mark about that one. Karen, John, any observations about like those 10 standards and how schools are or aren't in compliance with them?
We did kind of take a look at where they derived these 10 best practices from in those two different documents, the Department of Ed guidance and the Financial Literacy and Education Commission and their best practices, because there is not a one-to-one comparison between those two documents that leads you to these 10. So we did look at those pretty closely to make sure that we understood where those 10 best practices were coming from. And I do think that the Financial Literacy Commission and the Department of Ed's guidance, that sometimes they worded their best practices in different ways than what ended up as part of the final 10. But that generally these 10 best practices did come directly from those documents. It's not like a straight correlation. Sometimes like there was one best practice that then the GAO split up into three separate ones. So like on first look, you're like, well, how did they get three? They only had one over here, but it really is just kind of like how they organized it. And there is really like all, you know, they did get them from these two federal documents, the Department of Ed and the Literacy Commission.
Yeah, and I would just, I was really struck by your point, and I agree with it about, you know, six of these are critical and four of them are, you know, I don't want to say garnish, right? But they're nice to haves versus you must have. And particularly as, and I don't know if we're going to talk about this, but when the GAO report was released, there was new legislation introduced alongside it. There have been lots of legislative efforts in this area, and I think your point really nicely raises the challenges of doing something on the federal level, that what is important, what exactly do you need to measure? I think we can all agree on what's not helpful, what's critical. Clearly, there's already a diversity of opinion about what are the things that would count against you if you don't include it. And getting to a form or a piece of legislation that actually helps students but is still useful for institutions, it's going to be challenging. And this highlights that GAO can't even really clearly say exactly what is absolutely necessary and what's nice to have. So it's going to be a little bit of a challenge getting unified legislation there.
When you consider the fact that the college financing plan itself, back when they started this study in 2019, wouldn't have met these 10 standards. It does today, but it wouldn't have back then. So even if you were a school using it back then and you were using the government model, you wouldn't have met these 10 standards. Mm-hmm. So that's where I feel like a little bit more information would have been helpful. Again, we're not making any excuses for messing up like the six critical things. But the other one I questioned was like include actionable next steps. This is where I get to like, did the school just send them page one or did they send them the whole six pages? Because I guarantee you no aid office is obfuscating next steps. Next steps is like critical to the enrollment process. So I just have a hard time believing that that one would be left off unless there was some miscommunication. That is not to negate the overall findings and the critical issues that are identified here. But again, just looking at the 10 standards, I want to turn for a second to the reasons. So this was mostly questionnaire, but also the GAO interviewed at least two schools. And they gave three reasons why aid offers don't meet these standards. One of them was software providers. We've talked to software providers, Karen, in the past, and they've all told us that their software can do this. But then we talk to our members, and the members are saying it cannot easily do this or do it out of the box. Mm-hmm. Now, whether you can or can't, there's clearly a disconnect, because every time we talk to our members, they're saying they either don't know how or it requires some level of in-house customization or programming.
Right.
So software was given as a reason. Number two, resource constraints. We've talked about this before, but we've done surveying and all across higher ed, we have jobs that are going unfilled, and their critical job is to, one, get aid processed and financial aid out the door. so schools can students can actually attend their schools and pay for their cost of living, and then remain in compliance with everything that is the law. And I do just in a real world sense think that things like consumer disclosure that aren't up to A-plus standards just get pushed down the line. So resource constraints was cited.
Right.
The final one does make me bristle just a bit, and that is they cited competition. And this is where I do think institutions cross into a line that just doesn't work when we're talking about transparency and sunshine. And that is, in the name of competition, a school might be, even if they're not being purposefully trying to obfuscate costs or something, they might say, we're trying to show them that they can meet all of their expenses. But by doing so, they fiddle with net price, or they don't call something net price, or they lump loans in with grants. And even if it's done for non-nefarious reasons, it's confusing to students. Competition is working against transparency. We have a real problem, and transparency has to win out. Schools have to compete based on their actual net price, the price students are going to pay out of pocket. And we can't dance around that. That has to be like a primary standard.
Absolutely right. And I think this is, institutions need to see aid offers as exactly that, a critical information for students in making a determination, not a marketing document that's used to shift behaviors or induce students to enroll in the absence of clear and transparent information.
Yeah. And these issues span across sectors. So, you know, even open access institutions, where they're not usually working in the same enrollment management model that a competitive regional public or flagship public or selective private, it's not the same enrollment management model, but these issues span sector type. So these software, competition, resources, these were the three most common. And
yeah. Hey, Justin, yeah. I did have a reaction when you're talking about like the different pressures between the sectors and the competition points. I don't know if this is necessarily a point of competition, but I do feel like on the open access side, they are the sector who is most often to raise concerns about indebtedness and trying to make sure that their overall indebtedness numbers stay down. Their students are more likely to default, and they want to make sure that their students are borrowing manageable amounts that they're able to repay. And I feel like that ties into the aid offer discussion of how you're reflecting your costs and showing students that they can afford to come, but these are the loan amounts that you have. So I feel like there are competing pressures on that side of the equation as well.
Yeah, to put it more bluntly, Karen, there are community colleges out there because they don't have the discretion to lower loan amounts, even for part-time students who are attending at a part-time basis. They might bristle at showing like a full cost of attendance, because then people can max out their loans. And these schools are trying to control at an open access school repayment and default rates, and not always sure that students need all of those loans. And this is a competing pressure. But it's pretty clear that lawmakers are interested in showing students their full costs, and for good reason, and their full. But that doesn't mean, Karen, that they have to package them with all of those loans. Like a loan doesn't have to be put into an aid offer. Yeah. So there is a release valve there. Okay. John, you touched on legislation. I want to talk about that for just a moment, because there are three, at least by my count, three pieces of legislation in the last couple of years we've looked at. One bill is the Grassley bill, has several co-sponsors, introduced in both the Senate and the House. It's been around for a while. It was reintroduced in this last Congress. It's a pretty prescriptive aid offer bill. I mean, it goes through and gets very specific about what has to be on an aid offer. Then you have a bill that NASFA has supported in the past. It was co-sponsored by Representatives Trahan and Smucker, who are not like on the same ideological, you know, they're on ideological different sides of the aisle. It sort of codified our code of conduct, and probably like 8 out of the 10 things that you see here in these best practices, but allowed schools some flexibility as long as they met those 8 requirements. The latest one comes from Representative Fox this last week, that is really like a two-step process First, the school would send out an aid offer with direct expenses, and then the student is allowed to like basically build their own cost of attendance by adding in the indirect costs, and then the school goes from there. Karen, do I have those summaries just about right? Anything else you want to point out in those?
Yeah. The big thing about the Fox bill is that it has a lot of things that NASFA has supported in the past: standardized terms and definitions. These things have to be on the aid offer. It does not, though, have any type of standardized template. And it actually goes so far as to ban the Department of Education from developing a standardized template. But I think the most significant part here, and that we're still kind of thinking through, like, how might this work, is the two-step process: the direct expenses aid for that, and then a student opting in to receive aid for the indirect expenses. Like, how does that work operationally? Does that require that aid offers are all like a real-time experience where like you say, oh no, I don't need that, and then your cost adjusts and your aid adjusts? So we're still kind of working through how this might end up working.
Yeah, I could see some schools making this work really well, but those are also well-resourced schools who have fully fleshed out database administrators and web employees in the aid office that can make that work. So some questions, but as you point out, all three of these bills have things that NASFA has supported in the past. I don't think that any of them are perfect. I don't know that they would be the bills that NASFA would have written, except for maybe the FACT Act, which has not been reintroduced in this Congress. But at this point, Karen, I think it's fair to say we would support requirements on this because this gets at some of the big things aid offices said. If you have resource constraints because of all the other things you have to do, well, by mandating this, you sort of make this a priority on an institutional campus. It is then a Title IV requirement. And so for those reasons, NASFA has supported aid offer legislation in the past. We support it now. And it does address some of the concerns that our own members have raised about why they haven't been able to update their aid offers. John, any thoughts on that, at least from the resource allocation front?
Yeah, I mean, two things. One, which I think is important in your recap of the legislation, note that there is bipartisan interest in this, right? It's sort of sad to say, but that's notable in this Congress when you have an issue where there's bipartisan consensus that they want to do something. I'd also note that there is some flexibility. There's a variety, you know, of different approaches within those bills, but the idea of a strong federal role, possibly even a very prescriptive federal role, is not something that I think we generally are super comfortable with accepting. And so some of the inclusion of the flexibility, some of those things, you know, certainly offer positive indications of where legislation could be helpful. And it goes back to what I started with, that, you know, and you touched on this, Justin, that legislation does have a way of clarifying institutional priorities. And right now, we had certainly hoped that institutions have been tracking this issue, have been paying attention to this, have been thinking about this, frankly, just for their own internal purposes and how they serve their students, prospective students. The GAO report made it pretty clear that those changes, the self-regulation approach, hasn't given us the results we want. Now, I think we're doing some things to help try and push that conversation further. And again, reach more presidents, reach more senior administration officials on campuses and get them to act in that way. But, you know, there's bipartisan interest here. There's been a long period where we haven't seen the industry respond in the way we want to. The idea that legislation is going to come in, I think, you know, just you and Karen have already made clear, I think a lot of people on the campus might welcome that. And that's not often something from the Washington, D.C. national policy perspective we hear too often, that legislation is encouraged to step in because we're having trouble regulating ourselves, really.
Right. Please legislate us is not something you often hear from institutional lobbying or advocacy community.
And for the record, I am not saying that. I just want to say I can see where those trends are coalescing and where people might express that view.
That's okay. We, from NASFA side, we have supported federal ledge, and we will going forward too. And I don't want to put you, John, or AC on the spot, but I do want to follow up, John, on that and just say, let's talk about timeframes, realistic. So you have bipartisan support. You have bills in the House and the Senate. Now, they also all have to be reconciled. But like in a realistic world, when would this legislation be passed?
In a realistic world. And that's assuming we have an agreement, a bipartisan bill that everyone's happy with. And when would it be passed?
Bipartisan and bicameral, which we don't have.
Right? We don't have
several. Are you bills. So build that time in is what you're saying,
yeah.
Justin?
Yeah.
To build John? It in. Okay.
Yeah, I think you build that time, and I think you also build in the time that whatever proposal gets bipartisan and bicameral support is also going to then go through a vetting process of the public, where institutions will weigh in with their members who will not necessarily be members of the committee or members of leadership, but will have thoughts about how this might impact their institutions. That process tends to be the one that takes the most time, right?
John, let me just break in for a second and say, are we talking months or are we talking years till full implementation when you play that whole timeline out?
I think best case scenario, you're talking years.
Okay.
Yeah, not months.
So if we, and we don't want to wait years for the industry to improve. And for that reason, we many may have seen in the news that we have begun a task force that's a little different than task forces we've done in the past. NASFA's had several task forces on aid offers and consumer testing and transparency and disclosure. This one is different because it consists of 10 higher education associations, NASFA included. ACE is one of the supporting organizations. Mm-hmm. NACAC, our admissions counselors, is one of the supporting organizations, and then system heads and associations that represent college presidents. And we are coming together, looping in campus leadership in hopes that we can get the resources devoted to this at the campus level to make real changes now, before legislation and the timeline that John just talked about, you know, before waiting for all of that, let's try to make changes now. And then we'll be all in the better position when and if federal legislation does come.
I mean, I would just say on that too, we keep hammering this point, but this is something presidents should want for their campus, regardless of whether federal legislation was coming or not, right? Like, mm-hmm. This is not racing a countdown clock. This is, you should be doing the right thing. And I think there's a clear understanding of what the right thing is. That may vary in terms of how your form is constructed. It may vary in terms of what you choose to prioritize, but that transparency, that comparability, the ease of understanding for students, we know those are things that aid offers should include. And so, yes, absolutely, federal legislation is probably on the horizon, but that's not your metric, right? Your metric is do the right thing. And to the extent, you know, and I'm really quite obviously very happy that AC is participating, that NASA has done so much work in this area. The more we can do to push that message out, regardless of what the legislative climate is, that's all to the good. And we're certainly very hopeful that we're going to see a response as we put more attention to it, raise the profile, and get more colleges, frankly, to step up and do the right thing and do it in a public way to encourage their peers.
John, I was curious if, since you are working with the college presidents, like how much attention has the GAO report garnered amongst your members?
So I haven't heard directly from a lot of members about this. It's relatively recent, right? I will say that where you have heard, and I have heard directly from some presidents about this, trying to understand context and what else may be happening around this. I think this gets back to our conversation about what the legislative climate is. There is a lot of concern. The headlines were not good. Even presidents and some of the presidents I talked to are ones who have been trying really hard to make sure that they're at the right spot on this issue. It does not help as a community when there's a lot of public attention on the idea that as an industry, we are misleading people. And I think particularly those presidents who have been trying to be on the forefront of doing the right thing here, it's harmful to see it and frankly motivates them maybe to get their peers more involved, because a lot of people doing the right thing are getting tarred with the same brush of people who are not. So there is a clear sense of urgency from the folks I've heard from.
We'll include links in the show notes to the task force, to these bills that we've talked about, and to our summary of the GAO report, as well as the GAO report. People can check that out. I just want to say two final things, which is both the college financing plan and NASFA's models that, you know, we put out models for people to take a look at. Both those documents meet the 10 standards identified by the GAO. So if a school is looking for a place to start, it's a college financing plan you can work with, or one of our models that we've put on our website. We have multiple up there. They both meet those standards. So please start there and take a look. And you can always submit stuff over to NASFA as well. We've done this in the past. We've looked at schools' aid offers and given them feedback. You can submit those and we'll put the link in our show notes. Okay, We have used a lot of time on the GAO report. I have two things I want to follow up with, and maybe these aren't super long, but John, since the last time we were here, the president has extended the period of time till people have to start repaying, all because of the lawsuits that are happening on debt forgiveness. The Supreme Court has decided they're going to take this up. Can you walk us through really briefly, like, when will this be taken up by the Supreme Court? When will we have a decision from the Supreme Court?
So one is easier to answer than the other. Taken up by the Supreme Court, probably in March, we'll be having hearings. When will we hear, you know, assuming they neither expedite a decision nor slow walk one, probably, and this is actually, as we saw how the repayment pause was, resumption was structured, probably late spring, early summer. So end of May, beginning of June. Decisions start to come out from the first term of the Supreme Court. So that is what the expected timeline would be. Again, that's why the repayment pause is scheduled to run out either when a decision has clarified forgiveness or end of June 30th with a 60-day window to allow for additional payment. It's kind of an interesting way to structure the resumption of repayment around the Supreme Court's docket process. Which speaks again to how confusing and complicated this whole thing has gotten from we're going to forgive loans to now where are we in this really tangled litigation environment they're in.
Right. I'll just speak for myself, which I've been doing public policy and advocacy work now for a long time, 16 years, just about, if I was adding up correctly, at least at NASFA for 16 years. I am not an expert on litigation. So, where my work has always been was with the administration and with Congress and state legislatures from time to time, not with the Supreme Court, except in rare instances. So this will be interesting to see how all of this plays out. Next question, John, from aid officers is what's going on with year-end spending and when will we have Pell schedules for the 23-24 year? Is this going to get done before Christmas or not?
This is another one where one question's easy and the other one's harder, right? What's going on right now? They are feverishly attempting to get to an agreement without a whole lot of success. And frankly, it's somewhat understandable. There's really big dividing lines. Not worth going into all the details, but essentially the two questions that Democrats and Republicans are arguing over is what is the total size of the funding? They pretty much have agreement on what that will be. The reason it's pretty much is the second question is how do you divide that between defense and everything else?
If they do actually pass something on like the 23rd or the 24th, will you come back on Christmas and record an off the cuff with us?
I never leave, Justin. Sure.
Okay, good. And Karen, I've obviously already got you working on Christmas.
So. Yeah. Right. That was NASFA. The thing in my mind. Like, oh, geez, this is going to be right over Christmas, isn't it?
Well, I mean, if you feel bad for us, feel bad for the staff who might have to be drafting those bills over
too.
The holidays.
Yes. Yeah.
Thanks, John and Karen, for being here with us again. To our off-the-cuff community, we look forward to your discussion and your questions, and maybe we can get those on the air at the next episode. Okay, and we will see you again next week when we'll have David and Jill back on for our Ask Reg section. Until then, send us your comments. Remember to subscribe, tell a friend, leave a rating on your podcast app of choice. That helps other people find the podcast, and we will talk to you again very soon.